Welcome to Beyond the Data. I'm Dr. Phoebe Thorpe, and here with me today is Dr. Stephen Patrick from Vanderbilt University. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Today's session is about neonatal abstinence syndrome. Tell me, what is neonatal abstinence syndrome?
Well, neonatal abstinence syndrome is a drug withdrawal syndrome that newborns experience shortly after birth. It happens after they've been chronically exposed to opioids in utero before delivery. And what it typically looks like is I typically describe it as a colicky baby times five. It's a baby that's very fussy. They may have tremors, jitteriness. Sometimes they can have difficulty feeding enough time where they require a feeding tube. And less commonly, they can also have seizures. And what we know is that as the prescription opioid epidemic has grown over the last several years, we've seen an increase in the number of babies that have drug withdrawal. And some of our research suggests that there's been about a five-fold increase in the number of infants having drug withdrawal over the last decade. And by 2012, about one infant was born every 25 minutes having drug withdrawal in the United States.
Oh, that's a lot. So what is being done to treat these babies with the NAS?
Well, you know, one of the things that's happened over the last several years is that as the increases of infants with neonatal abstinence syndrome has occurred, the evidence base for what to do to treat them most effectively hasn't really been there. And we've seen a lot of variability from hospital to hospital on what's being done. So what we know as is becoming more and more apparent is that if we can begin to de-escalate some of the care, if we can keep mom and baby together, not separate mom and baby, that seems intuitive that we'd want to do that. But traditionally what's happened is that the infant gets taken away from mom and put into a neonatal intensive care unit where I work as a neonatologist. And that's a very loud environment. It can be chaotic, not a great place to go through if you're having drug withdrawal. So one of the best things that we're beginning to see is that if we keep mom and baby together and we control the environment, we promote breastfeeding when it's appropriate, and we begin to standardize the care that's given. We do things the same way every time. That appears to be more effective. And keeping mom and baby together, those sort of things that don't include giving a medicine, seems to control the symptoms that the babies have to require less medicine. But sometimes withdrawal is severe enough to where we do have to treat it with a medication. And we know that opioid withdrawal for babies is best treated with an opioid, like morphine or methadone.
So part of the problem is that the moms, it's a chronic exposure to the baby while it's inside the mom before it's born. What's being done to help and treat the moms during pregnancy?
So standard of care for treating a woman with opioid use disorder in pregnancy is medication-assisted treatment, drugs like methadone or buprenorphine. We know that that improves outcomes for the mother. She's less likely to relapse, less likely to get things like hepatitis C. And for the baby, they're more likely to go to term and have higher birth weights. But that those better outcomes are balanced by the increased risk of neonatal abstinence syndrome. One of the things that we're finding over time is that it's difficult for many women to find access to treatment. And as we've had so many more people that are now requiring treatment for opioid use disorder, finding treatment, particularly specialized treatment for pregnant women, is challenging. And one of the things that's happened more recently is some additional attention to that, including in the recently passed Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act that was passed by Congress just a few weeks ago, with a special focus on family-centered care for women with opioid use disorder.
And what is that act going to, what's the intent that it's going to help provide?
Well, it has pilot programs and grants to help facilitate, to help enable states to begin some programs for family-centered care. You know, in Nashville, where I live, there are very few family-oriented places. You can imagine a young mom with a long history of opioid use disorder who delivers an infant and may have another couple of kids, trying to do everything right and trying to find resources for her kids and having no place to sort of go in residential treatment with her infants and her other kids, maybe. And so there are a few places like that. Mm-hmm. Nashville has one. Mm-hmm. That beginning to sort of have family-centered comprehensive care is better for mom and better for baby. And I think that's one of the things that we really need to come around to understanding is that addiction is a chronic relapsing disease. It's a disease, not a moral failing. And we need to begin to view that like we do other chronic relapsing diseases like diabetes and think about how do we expand treatment for it, mm-hmm. for pregnant women. And one of the things that we begin to focus on too is primary prevention. How do we begin to control unnecessary prescribing, eliminating opioid use disorder before it becomes a problem, far before pregnancy, and making sure that every pregnancy is planned too, that we expand access to things like long-acting reversible contraception.
Yes, and you've hit on many, many important topics. As you were talking, I was thinking about the Surgeon General just has labeled it as an opiate crisis. And when we have a crisis, normally we have a kind of large scale coordinated response. And so some of what I hear you saying is about healthcare providers and what they can do. And can you expand a little bit more on that?
Yeah, I think we're beginning to realize that that we're using a lot of opioids. The Surgeon General's done work recently on this. The CDC has been has provided data to this for a long time now. In 2012, there were 259 million prescriptions for opioid pain relievers written in the United States. And in my state, in Tennessee, we have the second highest rate of opioid prescribing, about 1.5 prescriptions per person in the state. So it's you know, shouldn't be much of a surprise that we're beginning to see complications like overdose deaths and treatment facility admissions. And one of the things that we're seeing, of course, in my NICU is another complication from that, and that's neonatal abstinence syndrome. And so I think we're beginning to see things like the Surgeon General talking about prescription opioids more, talking to providers to think about what you're doing when you prescribe. You know, as the CDC, as the guidelines say, start low and go slow. Mm-hmm. And the Surgeon General really sort of calling to providers to really think about what you're doing before you prescribe. And certainly there are needs for pain medicine, but pain medicine should be used when it's appropriate and necessary. And there are also disparities that are in our system. You know, we have this system where we have perhaps overprescribing in some settings and still underutilization and undertreatment of pain in minority communities in many cases. And so it's a complicated situation. And in part, that's why this really requires a thoughtful public health approach that's grounded in primary prevention and goes towards expanding treatment and, again, thinking about addiction as a disease and not as a moral failing.
Yeah, that's a good point. And the other thing that what other policies or what else would you want policymakers to do to help with this crisis?
Well, I think, we recently saw the Comprehensive Addiction Recovery Act that was passed by both the Senate and the House and signed by the President, and I think that's a nice step forward. What I hope in the coming months happens is that we see that fully funded. I think that's an important step for our policymakers to make. And what we've seen is, you know, some of our work has been looking at, you know, how have some of these policies worked? You know, things like prescription drug monitoring programs. And what these programs do, they're databases where if I, as a prescriber, write a prescription for an opioid, someone goes and fills that prescription at a pharmacy, and then there's a database that collects those data. And we can monitor high-risk prescriber behaviors if I'm writing a whole bunch of an opioid, or high-risk patient behaviors if they're going from doctor to doctor to doctor to get a prescription. Some of our research suggests that PDMPs, or prescription drug monitoring programs, have been effective in reducing overdose deaths, and that's pretty important. So beginning to bolster these programs and support what we know is working in many communities, like prescription drug monitoring programs, beginning to educate the public and providers about prescribing, beginning to expand access to treatment, beginning to expand things like over-the-counter access to naloxone to save people's lives if they're having an overdose. Those are really important steps as we begin to respond.
Thank you so much for joining us. These are all very, very important points, and the session was just great. I really appreciate your work, and I think that you have done a fabulous job, phenomenal even, about putting a face on this part of the opioid crisis that was hidden. And I appreciate your work with treating the most vulnerable parts of our society. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been an honor to be here.
And thank you for joining us. Join us next month for Beyond the Data.